reasoning in terms of that number. It's better than what the consensus is, but how come?
Well, I think we run it off a model where we look at jobless claims and the purchasing manager surveys. And the latest numbers that just came out yesterday do suggest the number may be a little bit higher, more like 55,000, 60,000. Mm-hmm. But we're not all that negative. I think the big drop that we may see may come next month and not this month.
Okay, Kevin, though, your number more than 100,000. What exactly is it? Is it 105 still?
That's right. That's
okay.
Right.
Why are you kind of more pessimistic in terms of the number we might get today? Again, the consensus
is 75.
Well,
let's say I've been anticipating some of the things that John just referred to. We saw that the ISM manufacturing report, their employment index dropped sharply. Mm-hmm. And that's understandable at this stage of what appears to be a recession. Manufacturers are beginning to cut back. Their inventories are rising. They need to reduce production, and they lay workers off. The same is going on in the construction industry. Mm-hmm. The housing market is imploding, and now we see that commercial construction is also beginning to fall in a lagged effect, and there go a lot of construction jobs. So as we progress further into a recession, we should see bigger and bigger job losses. And it was really in anticipation of that that I'm at the higher end of the estimates.
Let's get back to talking about the jobs market, guys. So you're both expecting declines. That's what the consensus forecast is. John, what's going to be different then about this labor report? Is it that we're going to see more signs that it's spreading in terms of job cuts?
Yeah, I was going to make that point earlier, Carol. I think you're quite on target here. The job losses, particularly for business services and finance, are significant, and retail trade as well, mm-hmm. suggesting it's more than just construction, it's more than just manufacturing. What we'll see is a diffusion index that is published by the BLS will suggest that the job gains or the job losses particularly, are pretty widespread. We'll also see some pretty significant moderation, I think, in the wage numbers. Mm-hmm. And so when we look at the year-over-year wage gains, we'll see moderation there as well, suggesting that a lot of downward pressure in the labor market.
You know, Kevin, we always focus on those headline numbers, the non-farm payroll, the unemployment rate, but there's a lot of components to that jobs report. Anything else that you're focusing on?
Well, many of the things that John just referred to, the retail sector, for example. We know that consumer spending has slowed quite a bit. Mm-hmm. We're beginning to see store closings and cutbacks, and jobs are being lost in that sector. And then behind that, we have business services, all the companies that serve these businesses.
Right.
They're beginning to lose jobs. And we'll probably want to see whether that's spreading out further. I have to say, though, that there are a couple of core areas that we always see job gains, and that's medical care, mm-hmm. health, leisure activities, restaurants, vacation locations, things like this.
Right.
Those are still doing well, but they're not big enough to carry the weight of all employment gains. So we're going to see, I think, a substantial decline.
Kevin and John, it's a lagging in... Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead, John.
No, I was just going to say, building on Kevin's point, the one funny aspect of this, I think both Kevin and I would look at, is that the government sector continues to grow. So we've seen private sector job losses for the last 4 or 5 months, but the government sector is that one sector that continues to grow in jobs.
It is pretty, it's pretty interesting. Let me just ask you guys, though, in terms of what we're seeing on the labor front, I mean, it's a lagging indicator, and some folks say it's a lagging indicator, so don't worry so much about it. I mean, Kevin, what do you think?
Well, it is, but it's also a coincident indicator in the sense that it tells us the degree to which the economy is changing. The reason we pay so much attention to it is it's the best cyclical indicator of what's mm-hmm. happening right now. If we get a deep decline, say 200,000 jobs, we'll know that this recession is really gathering pace to the downside. If it's something more modest, minus 40,000, we'll say, oh, this is very mild. It's not of such concern.
Right. John, you were laughing when I said lagging indicator.
No, but I think, again, building upon the employment number is a key input into other estimates that we make, like industrial production mm-hmm. and personal income growth. And those are also coincident indicators, as Kevin had suggested. So the employment number itself is important, but it also feeds into a number of key indicators that the Department of Commerce looks as coincident indicators, and in fact, indicators of recession right now, industrial production and personal income growth.
John, you think the data points in terms of the labor market confirm that we are indeed in a recession? I mean, that GDP number came in better than expected. That surprised everyone.
I think the domestic economy is in a recession. I mean, if you look at the GDP number, it's inventories and exports that really generated that positive GDP number. The domestic economy in terms of consumers and business, they're in a recession.
Recession?
Yes. One qualification, it depends how long it lasts. you know, if it's only 3 or 4 months, then it's not a recession.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a possibility, because starting this month, we have these tax rebates being distributed.
Right.
And if that boosts demand and somehow generates a rebound in economic activity, we may refer back to this as the big slowdown of 2008. Rather than a recession.
Are those rebates, though, going to really help? I mean, everybody says it's just going to go to paying off some credit card debt and paying
gas bills and so on.
Right.
Well, yes, but people have to pay their credit card debt anyway, and they have to pay for their gasoline.
Okay.
So if they use these rebates for that, then it frees up money for other things.
To do some
It will generate a lot of spending.
John, Kevin, got about a minute left here. John, let me start with you. What would be a shocker
sure.
to the financial markets in terms of that jobs report today?
Oh, I think something like minus 150 or so would be a real shocker
mm-hmm.
because it sets up two problems. One, I think it really confirms that you're in recession. And second, it's going to change market expectations on Fed policy.
Right.
Because the Fed's going to all of a sudden look like, well, wait a minute, we can't really be neutral here because we still got a lot of downside risk on the U.S. economy.
Kevin, 20 seconds.
Well, I agree with that. Once a recession starts, you start to see numbers like minus 150, minus 200,000, and it goes on for months.
Right.
So it would really change expectations. But the biggest shock of all would be if we see a positive number.
Right.
Because that's completely unexpected.
That would be unexpected. We could take that surprise. All right, Kevin, John, thank you so much. Kevin Logan
sure.
at Dresner Kleinwort, and John Sylvia, Chief Economist.
Joining us with an instant reaction to the latest news on the economy, we have Bill Cheney here, Chief Economist at John Hancock Financial Services. He is in Boston this morning. And for a trader's perspective, we are joined by Jessica Hoverson from the Fixed Income Derivative Sales Group at MF Global. She comes to us from the Chicago Board of Trade. Jessica, let me ask you first, since you're there on the floor, was there serious excitement when this number came out? Because there was real reaction in the numbers on my screen.
Oh, well, the traders were definitely excited. I think empirically the numbers suggested that we were going to see a drop of 100 or more. I mean, the economy is incredibly weak and the financial sector has been struck considerably. So the traders who are coming from these financial firms have seen a lot of turmoil. So I think they're coming to the markets with empirical and an emotional reaction. And to see this number only decrease 20,000 is a bit shocking for them. And it's incredibly bearish for the treasuries. I think you're going to see some curve flattening. Probably going to see a major sell-off. There's been a lot of bears in the treasury market that have been arguing due to increased supply because of a growing budget deficit and it's horrible valuation in the treasury market. You're going to see a sell-off. And now that we see payrolls only drop 20K after an 80K drop in March, I think it's going to give them some reason to keep selling.
Yeah, Bill, let me ask you what you think. I mean, obviously, it's still a drop, a loss for the economy of 20,000 jobs, but how bullish is this number compared to or relative to expectations going into it?
I think it really is bullish. Obviously, a negative number is still negative, but it's so close to zero in the context of, you know, 130, 40 million job economy that essentially it means flat. And we're talking flat at a point where we're going into a big slug of stimulus rebate checks hitting the economy over the next month or two, which are almost guaranteed to boost consumer spending and retail jobs and of alleviate some of the pain we've seen. I think the issue with expectations, frankly, is that most of the expectations are of people who are on Wall Street, and Wall Street has suffered a lot more than Main Street, so there's sort of a biased view that things are worse than they really are for the economy as a whole.
Although the manufacturers got hit a little bit harder than expected, a drop in jobs of 46,000, and I think over the last 10 months we've only seen Wall Street lose about 50,000 jobs, so manufacturing also not looking extremely healthy with this drop.
Yeah, manufacturing is in a long-term downtrend and obviously has a lot of specific problems right now, particularly relating to the auto industry. I think longer term, the outlook for manufacturing is reasonably good given the strength of the export sector. The weak dollar is powering a lot of growth in manufacturing, and it's not translating into a lot of jobs yet, but I think over the course of time, there's actually some light at the end of that tunnel. I think the construction sector is the one where I would be most worried that there are more shoes to drop.
Let me go back over to Jessica. Jess, you know, we've seen a lot, or very little volume, I should say, over the last few weeks, and people are not really willing to take on a lot of risk until yesterday. Do you think we're going to see more people coming into the markets after this bullish number?
I do. I think that people were very hesitant in front of the non-farm payrolls, especially after the corporate profit sector was boosted solely, in my opinion, by growth abroad. So we're seeing a very weak domestic economy exhibited in these corporate profits. We see the FOMC drop 25 basis points in both the discount and the funds. And so people don't want to step in front of the labor market, which definitely is one of the key drivers of trade down here.
All right. Hey, Jessica Hoverson, thanks so much for joining us. Also, our thanks
Thank you.
To Bill Cheney there, Chief Economist.